Our interest is myeloid cells. Why myeloid cells? I don't know what it says to you, but those are the cells that come from the bone marrow and go different locations, and depending on the environment, they can do different things. They are very, they have the highest plasticity in us. They can convert themselves even they have differentiated. Why they are so important in cancer? These myeloid cells could form almost half of the mass in some of the cancers, breast cancer being one example of those. There have been attempts to remove all of these, meaning that you kill them all. That's bad thing because there are some benefits to have around them. Instead of killing, we need to do something else. And that something else we have learned to do. And that is to reprogram them. Not to serve the benefit of the cancer cells, but to serve the benefit of our own immune system, so can we can activate the immune system, attack against those cancer cells. This is a strong statement I make now, but I say that we are the world leading company to reprogram these myeloid cells. And when you look at the data I'm going to present, I hope that you start to believe, and then tomorrow to go shares of this company. The target molecule is clever one. It has a historical name, but obviously I like the name a lot, clever one target. We have an antibody that can block the function. The antibody is called Bexmarilimab. It's the in-name, official name given by WHO, and that's the generic name of the company. Once the product is on the market, definitely we'll have a different name. We have now evidence that we can control the tumor environment in the solid cancer tumors and in the hematological cancers. And that's very interesting because if you think about the sales of the cancer drugs, 300 billion, and we still don't have capacity or skills to treat them. Even this cancer immuno-oncology development has been really fast and significant. We only treat maybe 20% of the population. 80% have no choice in that category either. So significant early results, patent protection running up to 2037, which is really important when you want to build a protection for your product. And obviously, with the results I'm presenting, we have a significant interest from the big pharma side as well. What we learned was really, from the very beginning, is this reprogramming of these myeloid cells. And when they are in the tissue, they are often called macrophages. There is this type which we call immunosuppressive macrophages, especially when they are in the tumor, they are called tumour-associated macrophages. They are the ones that actually suppress the immunity within the tumor. And it allows tumor to grow first locally, and when they take over the whole system, then they start to spread. It's called metastasis, and that is killing us. This type of the cell is needed in physiological setting as well. And the best example is pregnancy. Because the growing embryo, fetus, is a foreign material to the mother's immune system. It has to be protected. These cells come from the bone marrow and travel to the placenta and build immune barrier between the embryo tissue and the mother's immune system. If there wouldn't be this barrier, there wouldn't be possible for the embryo to grow 9 months in the mother. When the pregnancy is over, labor has taken place, these cells disappear. Similar situation happens during the wound healing because we do not want to be immunized against our own protein fragments. These cells come to the wound site when the healing is over, like in here, I can't tell why I have this one, but anyway, then they disappear again. So needed cells. This may explain why Bexmarilimab has extremely good safety profile. The similar system is used physiologically in certain occasions, and obviously it cannot produce any side effects. And this is amazing that we have so good efficacy already now demonstrated both in solid cancer and the hematological cancer, and yet there is no safety problem. And clinicians are very motivated. So one single antibody treatment given IV, typical biotech product, humanized antibody, and it converts the immunosuppressive macrophages into immune activators. This is now all published. There are two very crucial publications in the very high-class journals, where all the details can be carefully, you know, read if you really want to go into there. But I will summarize. This is directly from one of these journals. It's called Visual Abstract. It tries to tell what is in there. What we learn first, that we do have a clinical benefit, and you can see the different cancer types, depending on the cancer types. And these are last-line patients, had no options anymore. When they had the response from Bexmarilimab, they extended their overall survival 3.5 times. No other treatments, and we went single-agent treatment with Bexmarilimab, 3.5-fold increase in the overall survival. It's a pity that it was not randomized. If it would have been randomized, we probably would be on the market already now. But what you can say. But what we saw in this paper, with those patients who had been treated with the Bex, we had a biopsy pre and post Bexmarilimab administration. And we analyzed those. Yes, inside the tumor, we get activation of these macrophages like we describe in ex vivo or in animal models. We really can change the tumor environment, and that's really needed. We also realize that we increase one very important fighting molecule, what the T cells are using, and that's the interferon gamma. That is one of the tools our immune system is using to activate the immune system, and that goes up. And if it goes up, then you have a benefit in your survival zone in that curve. But that comes the interesting part. This molecule is also expressed on the surface of the myeloid leukemia cells. They have the same original stem cells as these monocytes and the macrophages. And they are expressing CLEVER-1, the same molecule we are targeting in those solid cancer cells, or solid tumor environment. So now we have a situation that the same CLEVER-1 is on the surface of these cancerous leukemia cells. And why it's there and what it has to do if we block the function of it. And this we have worked out as well. So in the leukemia patients, not only we activate the bone marrow as we did with the solid cancer tumor patients, now we can target directly these ugly looking blasts. They really look ugly in the microscope when you look at them. These are the ones that take over your bone marrow, run out of your bone marrow viability, and you run out of the production of your normal blood cells. They take you over. And especially this myeloid leukemia is awful, one of the most aggressive ones. Roughly 90% of the patients die within the first 2 years post observing these cells in the circulation. Awful. And you don't believe this, there are no treatments today that are effective. I will come to that point. But we already then learn from using human cells that now we have a separate mode of action against these leukemia cells, and that is to close the mitochondrial ATP production. When we block CLEVER-1, they cannot anymore produce the energy, ATP, what they need to survive and just to be there. They start to shrink and they collapse. So we reduce the viability at the same time when we activate the immunity. This is almost like engineering work for this target. And we just got there. We didn't aim that, but we realized that this is now the real target we have to target. And here we go. The MDS, which is part of this myeloid leukemia, is the patient group we have now decided to focus. And I wanted to show first what kind of a market opportunity this could be. They are called high-risk MDS, meaning that they have a tendency to get other mutations and their differentiation of the cells when they become more aggressive ones. When they become really aggressive, they are called acute myeloid leukemia. So this is like a pre-stage of that. But there is no treatment for these patients. There are some 15% out of these 100,000 patients in Europe and US alone, annually, that could go to these intensive therapies, which are either mutation-driven or there are some other chemotherapies that actually could be tried, but they are not very effective. If you have any effect, you become transplant candidate, and you may find a donor, and you get a new bone marrow. But that's only 5% of all of this population. What is important to note, if you go this pathway, you have costed to the society roughly million pounds. We spent hundreds of thousands pounds for all these people, even if we don't have any cure for them. These are the lucky ones, and out of these, only 50% really get a permanent life thereafter. You know, you don't want this even to your enemy. This is really awful condition. So if we spend 100,000, roughly about this, it's in the US, it's insurance. In Europe, it's health system. You have all had math in the school. How much is that? That's 10 billion. 10 billion. And there's no drugs. The market is just waiting us to get there. Come on. So we made typical dose escalation with these patients, got very interesting results, and I will come to that one. We have now moved into a what they call phase two dose optimization, which is required by FDA mainly, and that's where we are at the moment. This is only 32 patients, and once that data is available, we move to the pivotal part. And obviously we'll discuss with the regulators all the time. So this is now ongoing. From this data, we will get initial data on the second quarter of this year and final data on the last quarter of this year. We have sites in US and in Finland at the moment. We are planning to expand to other locations in Europe and also increase the site number also on the US side. But we have all the significant sites involved already. City of Hope close to LA, MD Anderson in Houston, then Yale, on the East Coast, Northern Carolina, and also Fred Hutch in Seattle. Really significant cancer centers. And they all are extremely excited about this possibility, and we have a lineup of additional sites. I come to that one a bit later, but let's look at the results. I'm not going into details. I can just say that this is extremely well tolerated. There are very few side effects compared to many number of other conditions. And the same we observed already with those 200 patients we carried out in the solid cancer tumor area. We also know that we can activate the bone marrow when we give a Bexmarilimab. You can see here dosing 1 mg, 3 mg, 6 mg per kg. And you can see that while the dosing is ongoing, we get the accumulation of the T cells, CD8 cells, into a bone marrow, which indicates that yes, we have now immunoactivation going on. And obviously, the purpose of that is to try to generate cells that can recognize these cancer cells and maybe in the long term even generate the antibodies so that it's a permanent cure. That remains to be seen, but it's very exciting to note that we do have really immune response taking place, and that results in the antigen presentation capacity, but I will not go into that one. This is the status last fall in November. This is the material we presented at the ASH meeting, and there is an increase in number of patients who are on the trial when we are progressing. Keep in mind that this 6 mg per kg was the latest cohort we started, and obviously that was mainly in the fall. But everybody who has this arrow in there still on the trial. We had roughly 50% overall response rate across the different indications and dosing cohorts, even it was not yet optimized. But one striking feature really was that these MDS patients, we had 100% response rate. All of them responded to our treatment. It's really unheard. We had high-risk MDS and also refractory populations. One of the very first ones went already to the bone marrow transplantation, so obviously we really don't know. But what was also important, these are many of them complete remissions, meaning that they lost their immune blasts, the cancer cells, which is obviously the purpose. And it's very easy to follow these patients from the blood samples, We also get a bone marrow sample once a month so that we get the readout all the time when we are progressing. Just to show the blast number decline, and in another way, this is the waterfall plot where we can see that we reduce the blast number among these. Then today's announcement was related to the other treatment options what these patients have. And especially when we went to US, we started to get patients who were on other treatments prior coming to our trial. They came to our trial because they had relapsed leukemia, or they just become refractory and nothing helped them. There was Macrolimab, anti-CD47. Gilead has now stopped the hem area totally. They paid $5 billion for 47 company. So that's out of the game at the moment. There is a Venetoclax, that is a BCL2 inhibitor, mainly developed by AbbVie. Very toxic to the people, very toxic. The combination with the azacitidine is really awful condition. You almost have to keep the patients in the emergency unit. And then one product, Patolimab, Novartis product, targeting TIM-3 pathway. It's a pathway which I have difficulties to understand what it has to do with the myeloid cells, but it's in the phase 3. But also that patient became refractory and then came to our trial, and there are no blasts anymore in the bone marrow. So I have to say that I couldn't be in a funnier situation, because we obviously are also talking to these companies at the moment because they have some interest in getting access.
So, how many?
One minute. Extremely clear pathway. Doing this at the moment, going to the regulator, then doing hopefully small final pivotal pathway, and then have a BLA filing in 2025. So if all goes well, we get funded, 23, this product will be available for the myeloid patients. Because I'm running out of the time, so as I said earlier, we have now started that phase 2 part, initial data on the second quarter, long-term durability data somewhere at the same time, and then full readout of that phase 2 part on the last quarter. We continue the expansion. We have a Boston office nowadays in use. Partnering discussions are really heavy. I can say that 20 plus companies are in talks with us at the moment. And then based on the clinical feedback we have obtained, we now are setting additional programs, because the clinicians are thinking that this is not only limited to MDS, there are other potentials, and those are underway at the moment. And at the same time, at one point, we will initiate this combination with the PD-1 blockade. So looks to me like we have been able to keep the timeline. Progress with the results are really encouraging. And with all of that, I think I'm pretty much done. I just wanted to show that we have some additional board members, and especially Maria Luisa, our previous CMO, is now the board member, and Christina Roth from Bayer joined us, who is really marketing all the Bayer cancer drugs. And obviously, that is was really important to have a diversity at the board level. So with this, I'm pretty much done. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Markku. So you're sounding very confident. You were saying all things being equal, all things being well, that this could be accessible to patients in 2025.
Or six. We filed the BLA and before the regulators can actually...
Okay, so within 2 years, yeah. You are sounding very confident.
Never seen data like this in my life.
You've never seen data like this in your life. And this is the 21st year of the company.
That's correct.
And you had a life before the company as well.
I did, yeah.
And you've never seen data like this?
No.
Okay, but has anybody else seen data like this?
Many of people have seen this data. But if you think about the revolutions, what has taken place, PD-1s didn't come like that on the market. They really had a lot of failures before they actually started to understand how it has to be dosed and what are the populations they actually could help. And this interferon gamma is well accepted in the literature that if that is not up, there is no benefit from PD-1 blockade at the moment. So it's an indication that we have to develop also screening system for the patients. I didn't go into that one, but the companion diagnostic is obviously something that we also develop at the same time as a background.
Questions for Markku.
Hello. You had plan A and B. What is your plan B?
Plan B is that for some reason, FDA would like to us to make a randomized trial with this MDS population. My question there is that what is the other group who is not receiving Bexmarilimab? And people are saying that it could be doctor's choice. Maybe they keep with the azacitidine, but we know that it's not going to help. So the question there is that can regulator request us to do randomized trial where the patients are put on the arm, which we already know it's not going to be effective? And I really would like to get that answer one day in written form. Can they if they can not say that, then we go with the single arm, and that takes us to the market.
And how do you choose the patients by itself?
These are well-defined patients. They are based on the typing, the cells and other biomarkers, and it's mainly the pathology labs that actually provide the information. And as I said, we have very experienced a sites involved with the trial. So I'm trustful really in that aspect as well. But failure in screening, I know that is a risk.
Thank you.
Markku, thank you for that. I believe you said that it was a single dose, the treatment with Bex, is that correct?
No.
No, okay.
No, the cycle is once a week. And it can be reduced once the blast number goes down. So protocol allows the extension of the period, and it can be increased again if they come back. But we don't yet have a full understanding, and that is the reason we have to really follow these patients at least up to 2 years.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just very briefly, and I apologize if you covered this at the beginning because I was a bit late, but do you need any funding, and what are your plans for to fund the development or to get to the commercial phase?
Biotech companies always need funding unless they make a licensing deal. Last year was really bad, but we have been able to fund ourselves mainly from a Scandinavian sources. We have Leukemia Lymphoma Society from US as one of the investors as well. And obviously we have been able to use their clinical network really to identify the PIs and sites in US. And we have a regular meetings with them, they advise us. But obviously we are now at the turning point where I'm traveling a lot, and you may guess why I'm traveling a lot.
So why are you traveling a lot?
He asked, do we need funding?
Okay, so you just said that last year was bad in your response to the gentleman. But recently you were invited by an investment bank to go and talk to them, to present to them. Again, something that hasn't been happening frequently within the career path of Faron Pharmaceuticals. What did this investment company say to you about the market? Was this JP Morgan that you were speaking to?
Yeah, I was just asking, can I say the name? Yeah, it was JP Morgan's health conference, one of the biggest in the pharmaceutical area. They force all the CEOs to come and give a talk. So you have Pfizer, you have GSK, you have all the big names over there, and you get to see them, and if you are lucky, you even get to talk to them. But the point there is that there are a lot of other meetings which really focus on trending and financing and all of that. And one interesting thing which I didn't know the magnitude of, and that is there were maybe 200 M&A events last year, and the value all of that was $156 billion. So somebody got a lot of money. And what will happen to that money, I don't know, but the anticipation is that it started to come back to the life science area. And obviously, I hope that, because we need all these new drugs. Then another issue is that these drug companies do generate a lot of cash. So many of them have from 10 to 80 billion dollars, just cash sitting there. What to do with that one? So I'm obviously understanding that it will kind of continue these M&A activities and the licensing activities this year.
So 2024, did JP Morgan give an indication that they thought that this year was going to be a better year for M&A and funding? And
oh, absolutely. The sentiment was much, much better than a year ago. Absolutely. Yeah.
So out of all those 156 billion, how many billions would Bexmarilimab be worth?
You don't believe if I say it, but if it happens theoretically that we can improve the current PD-1 blockade, these immuno-oncology products, there are many of them by a number of companies, and if they sell 50 billion this year and you double that, so you start to wonder, if that is the case, why not this could be in billions as well as the other ones? I said about the MDS that alone could be in the billions. And you can model this with the peak sales estimates and with the risks involved. But if you take any of these numbers, they are so humongous that it's difficult to really believe that it is the case. But that's the purpose. We need to really grow big, and hopefully that happens this year.
Give us a number.
It could be another 50 billion.
Very good. Any more questions for Markku?
Can you please tell us a little bit about your competitors, and is Angle one of them?
We have been building IP protection for the antibody Bexmarilimab over the years. The major filings were carried out in 2017. They are now approved globally, more than 95% of the pharmaceutical markets. And they will last up to 2037. We have a bit unusual situation with the IP. And obviously, that is an interest for the big pharma as well. We have been filing additional ones. So that's on the protection side. Would there be biosimilars one day? I don't really know. But to get there may not be something that we can do alone. So we have to be careful who is the right partner to us. And if you ask me what is the right one before she does that, somebody who has, for example, a PD-1 blockade already in the market and wants to increase their efficacy, then we can build a combination program. With the hematological malignancies, if this is really true that we have a single agent efficacy, even in the first line, then we don't need anybody except that one, and that could just build its own business. But it's a bit too early, really, to fragment all of these. But a lot of thinking, and we are using really outsiders also to help us.
We're out of time, but at the very beginning you said that once Bexmarilimab is on the market, it will have a different name. Which name would you be comfortable with?
I can't say that, because if you start to use names prior they are approved by the regulators, you run into problem. You have to keep them secret. But there are ways, and you need to prepare for this one. There are companies who are helping you. If you look at the GLP-1, you must know these anti-obesity drugs, how interesting names they different have. But they came out once they got to the market, and there will be more of them to come.
I think it needs to be called Markumab or something like that. Markku.
Right, I appreciate that.
Thank you, Markku. Thank you very much. Thank you.